Hi everybody. In this video, we'll be using what we've learned in the past couple of lessons to think about how vibrational and rotational energy levels play out in spectroscopy. It's always good to have the big picture in our minds of what types of light correspond to what types of transitions in molecules. Typically, the absorption of X-rays corresponds to the breaking of bonds and ionization. Ultraviolet and visible photons lead to electronic excitations. The absorption of infrared light leads to vibrational excitations, and the absorption of microwaves leads to rotations. In this video, we'll be focusing on infrared spectroscopy, so we're thinking about cases in which the vibrational level is excited. The idea is that an infrared photon is shined at a molecule, and when that photon, when that specific amount of energy is absorbed, we see a peak in the infrared spectrum corresponding to the amount of energy that was absorbed. In infrared spectroscopy, it's actually not just the vibrational energy levels of a molecule that are excited. Within each vibrational energy level, there are a number of quantized rotational energy levels. I'd like to point out in this diagram that the notation actually changes slightly from what we've seen before. Just as we saw in the harmonic oscillator model, the vibrational energy levels correspond to a quantum number V that can have any value from 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. But when we previously looked at rotational motion, we said that the energy levels of the spherical harmonic functions depended on a quantum number lowercase l. In spectroscopy, the quantum number associated with rotational motion is usually called capital J. So just be aware that the capital J's that you see in this video are completely analogous to the lowercase l's that you saw previously. So, when we look at an infrared spectrum, each peak can actually correspond to a transition in which both V and J change. We'll be looking only at diatomic molecules. The spectra of diatomic molecules are particularly clear because there's only one well-defined vibrational mode. Before we can look at a spectrum and rationalize it, there's one more idea I'd like to mention. Not all peaks are equal. Some transitions lead to strong peaks, and some transitions are completely invisible in an infrared spectrum. We're really not going to talk much about the math here, but the requirement is that in order for a molecule to absorb or emit a photon, the transition dipole moment cannot be zero. In the equation on this slide, psi f and psi I represent the final and initial wave functions in a transition, and mu is the dipole moment operator. The idea behind this requirement is that in order for a molecular transition to interact with an incoming photon, they have to share a component of their directionality. Again, I'm only mentioning this in passing, so don't worry about it if this statement is hard to understand. Really, what's important are the practical consequences of this. There are certain restrictions on the initial and final quantum numbers, V and J, and those restrictions are called selection rules. For diatomic molecules, what we need to know is that first of all, only heteronuclear diatomics have infrared peaks. Second, only transitions in which the vibrational quantum number V either increases or decreases by 1 show up in a spectrum. And third, there's an analogous selection rule for rotation that says that we only see peaks when the rotational quantum number J either increases or decreases by 1. In addition to these selection rules, there's another practical point that's worth mentioning. At room temperature, almost all diatomic molecules are in their vibrational ground state, V equals zero. That means that, although it's possible for there to be infrared peaks corresponding to, for example, V equals 3 being excited to V equals 4, we really are only going to see large peaks corresponding to V equals 0 being excited to V equals 1. These are called the fundamental peaks. To remind ourselves of these selection rules, let's take a quick look at a few examples of peaks that we will see in the spectrum and peaks that we will not see. We will see peaks in which V equals 0 is excited to V equals 1, and J is either increasing or decreasing by 1. But we won't see peaks in which J is not changing, or V is not changing, or J is increasing or decreasing by more than 1. Now we can actually think about at what energies we expect to find these peaks. Let's think first about the vibrational part of these transitions. As we've seen, quantized vibrational energy levels are most simply represented by the harmonic oscillator model. In the harmonic oscillator model, we saw that a mass m on a spring with constant k has energy levels v plus 1 half times h bar times the square root of k over m. For a vibrating diatomic molecule, the harmonic oscillator model tells us basically the same thing, where the only difference is that rather than mass m, we have a reduced mass mu. The bottom line is that the energies are equal to a quantum number v plus 1 half times a collection of constants. In spectroscopy, the ideas are the same, but the notation is a little bit different. The equation at the bottom of this slide represents the vibrational energy of a diatomic molecule in spectroscopic notation. The tildes just mean that in spectroscopy, we typically work in units of wave numbers, or reciprocal centimeters, rather than more traditional energy units like joules. So this equation is telling us that the vibrational energy of a diatomic molecule has a couple of terms. The first term is nu tilde times v plus 1 half. In other words, v plus 1 half times a collection of constants, just as the harmonic oscillator model tells us. The second term is a collection of constants times v plus 1 half squared. This is actually just an experimental correction to the harmonic oscillator model, to capture the fact that a vibrating diatomic molecule is not actually a harmonic oscillator. It doesn't actually obey Hooke's law exactly. For our purposes in this video, we will actually ignore this second term and assume that vibrational energy is perfectly captured by the harmonic oscillator model. We can say something similar about the rotational motion of our diatomic molecule. Previously, we solved the particle on a spherical shell model to find that the quantized energies of a rotating particle are equal to a quantum number L times L plus 1 times h bar squared over 2mr squared, where m is the mass of the particle and r is the radius of the spherical shell. If we look at a rotating diatomic molecule, the story is very similar with just a couple of small differences. First of all, rather than using the quantum number lowercase l, we typically use the quantum number j in spectroscopy. And second, rather than using the mass m of one particle, we use the reduced mass mu of the diatomic molecule. When talking about a diatomic molecule rather than a rotating particle, we often call this model the rigid rotator model rather than the particle on a spherical shell. And the key thing to notice is that the energy levels are equal to our quantum number j times j plus 1 times a collection of constants. As we did with vibration, we can translate these equations into spectroscopic notation. This equation tells us that the rotational energy of a diatomic molecule is the sum of two terms. The first is our rigid rotator term. Energy is a collection of constants times j plus 1. And the second is a small correction to the rigid rotator model. As we did with the harmonic oscillator model, we'll ignore this small correction for the purposes of our discussion. Now that we've reviewed the basics of vibrational and rotational motion, let's figure out at what energies the infrared peaks of a diatomic molecule will show up in a spectrum. Since we're ignoring the higher order corrections to the harmonic oscillator and rigid rotator models, a given energy level is the sum of two terms, the harmonic oscillator term and the rigid rotator term, which are shown in this equation. When a diatomic molecule absorbs an infrared photon, a peak shows up in the spectrum corresponding to the difference between the initial and final energy levels. So, if we plug in the initial and final quantum numbers v and j corresponding to a given transition, we can find the energy of a peak. Let's do that for our fundamental infrared peaks, the transitions corresponding to excitations from v equals 0 to v equals 1. Remember, the selection rules tell us that we only see infrared peaks where the rotational quantum number j is either increasing by 1 or decreasing by 1. Let's think first about the peaks where j increases by 1. So we'll say that j starts at some initial value ji, and during the transition, it increases to ji plus 1. We can plug the initial and final values of v and j into this equation, because we know that v increases from 0 to 1, and j increases from ji to ji plus 1. We can then group the vibrational terms together and the rotational terms together. We can multiply out the polynomials. And finally, we can cancel a couple of terms to find that these peaks show up at energies nu plus b times 2ji plus 2, where ji, the initial value of the rotational quantum number, can have any value 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. So these are the positions of half of our peaks, the peaks where j increases by 1. We can do something very similar with the peaks where j decreases by 1, where j goes from some initial value ji to ji minus 1. Again, we can plug in the initial and final values of v and j. We can group the vibrational terms and the rotational terms, and multiply out the polynomials. And we find that these peaks are found at nu plus b times negative 2ji. In this case, since we know that the quantum number j decreases by 1, it must start at least 1, so ji must be 1, 2, 3, etc. These are the other half of our peaks, where j decreases by 1. Notice the color code on this slide, where the peaks where j increases by 1 are in blue, and the peaks where j decreases by 1 are in green. We'll continue using that color scheme in the next few slides. Putting all the peaks in both halves of our spectrum together, we have this. Allowed infrared peaks at nu minus 2b, nu minus 4b, nu minus 6b, etc. Those are the peaks where j decreases by 1. And in spectroscopy, they're often called the P branch of the spectrum. And also peaks at nu plus 2b, nu plus 4b, nu plus 6b, etc. Those are the peaks where j increases by 1, and those are often called the R branch of the spectrum. Notice that because we've ignored higher order corrections to the harmonic oscillator and rigid rotator models, we actually have peaks that are approximately equally spaced, except that we're missing the peak in the middle. There's no peak at nu, because of the selection rules. So let's think about the information that we have in a spectrum. By looking at where the fundamental peaks are centered, we can find nu. Nu is the vibrational constant of our molecule, and from nu we can find the strength of a bond, the force constant. And based on the spacing of these fundamental peaks, we can find b, the collection of rotational constants, and from that we can find the length of a bond. So a lot of important physical information, the strengths and lengths of bonds in diatomic molecules, can be found from the infrared spectrum. Let's actually look at the infrared spectrum of HCl. In this spectrum, the energies of the peaks are shown on the horizontal axis, and their intensities are shown on the vertical axis. Notice that the way that energy is plotted, lower energies are on the right and higher energies are on the left. The peaks at lower energies in this spectrum correspond to the P branch, where J is decreasing by 1. I've labeled the initial and final values of J in the first few peaks. And at higher energies, we have the R branch of the spectrum, where J is increasing by 1. As we predicted, we have peaks that are approximately equally spaced, but missing the peak in the center. The peaks aren't exactly equally spaced because, remember, we ignored higher order terms in the harmonic oscillator and rigid rotator models. We're not really in a position to talk much about the relative heights of the peaks yet. But the short story is, the heights of the peaks depend on the fraction of the molecules that initially start at a given energy level, which depends on temperature. We'll revisit that idea in statistical mechanics in the next quarter. But there is one more question I'd like to pose. If you look closely at these peaks, each peak is split, with a more intense peak on the left and a less intense peak on the right. Why do you think that is? I'll give you a few seconds to think about it. And remember, this sample is HCl. This is a tricky question. In a naturally occurring sample of HCl, there are two different isotopes of chlorine, Cl35 and Cl37. We saw that the reduced mass mu appears in both the harmonic oscillator and rigid rotator energies. And while mu for HCl is always going to be close to the mass of a hydrogen atom, it's slightly different for HCl35 and HCl37. So we have a whole set of peaks corresponding to the infrared spectrum of HCl35, and right next to that, slightly offset, we have a whole set of peaks corresponding to the infrared spectrum of HCl37. That's all for now. Now that we've covered the basic models of motion in quantum mechanics, we're in a position to start thinking about what the Schrödinger equation says about a hydrogen atom.